his campaign that in his mind, the end of getting elected justifies the means. To him, it appears to justify betrayal of principle and of friend.
The campaign soured Eisenhower's relationship with his former commander-in-chief. He had worked with President Truman to shape the post-war world, eager to execute Truman's foreign policy. But over time, he became convinced that Truman's domestic spending was hurting the economy. Now Eisenhower ran against Adlai Stevenson by attacking what he called Truman's mess in Washington.
We shall cast away the incompetent, the unfit, the cronies, and the chiselers. And it won't take years of congressional investigations and a lot of tax money to clean out the whole mess.
And they began taking cracks at each other that got worse and worse. Truman especially, saying General Eisenhower doesn't know any more about politics than a pig knows about Sunday. And they were so furious with each other. When the transition took place, Eisenhower refused to go into the White House to have a cup of coffee with President Truman. And then Truman joined Eisenhower in the open limousine for the ride to the inaugural. And they say that silence was the coldest you ever heard.
Truman did not think Eisenhower was prepared for the presidency. He mused, "Poor Ike, it won't be a bit like the army. He'll sit here and he'll say, do this, do that, and nothing will happen." That was not to be the case. Americans had elected the victorious general of World War II to deal with the problems of the Cold War.
Climb aboard a butterfly and take off on the breeze. Let your worries fly.
While they settled down in the burgeoning suburbs and continued what would be called a baby boom.
The land where dollar bills are falling off the trees.
But Eisenhower saw the American economy and way of life under threat.
Every day.
War in Korea had dragged on for 2.5 years. The war had begun when communist North Korea invaded the South. The U.S. rallied the United Nations, while China sided with her communist neighbor. Eisenhower wanted to end the war. Republican hardliners hoped he would roll back communism in Korea and all over the world. Instead, Eisenhower settled for limiting the spread of communism, for containing the communists. This had been Truman's policy. Eisenhower made it America's policy for the long haul of the Cold War. But containing aggression with ground forces was costly in men and treasure. Early in his term, Eisenhower spoke with eloquence of the cost of war.
Every gun that is made, every warship launched, every rocket fired signifies, in the final sense, a theft from those who hunger and are not fed, those who are cold and are not clothed. The cost of one modern heavy bomber is this: a modern brick school in more than 30 cities.
The cost of one modern destroyer is just this: 5 fine, fully equipped hospitals in towns across America. And he went on to sketch out the cost of the arms race to the American people.
This is not a way of life at all. in any true sense. Under the cloud of threatening war, it is humanity hanging from a cross of iron.
In 6 months, he ended the war in Korea and brought the troops home. He had threatened the Chinese with nuclear weapons, but Americans didn't seem to care. Eisenhower kept the defense budget down by relying on nuclear weapons. They were cheap. He would contain communist expansion by threatening massive nuclear retaliation. Covert action was also cheap. It had served Eisenhower well in the war against Hitler. He would fight the Cold War with the CIA as a secret presidential army. To protect Iran and British oil from Soviet meddling, the CIA stirred up a riot and returned the Shah to his throne. No matter, a legitimate leader was overthrown. He avoided another war in Asia when he refused to send bombers or atomic bombs to help France fight the communists in Vietnam. His commitment to a non-communist South Vietnam seemed harmless enough at the time. Eisenhower wanted to avoid war, contain communism, and protect the American economy. He often worked with a style that Vice President Richard Nixon called devious in the best sense of the word.
Eisenhower maintained support with the great beaming smile he had acquired in World War II. But simultaneously, he was a political sophisticant who operated behind the scenes, pulling strings, and I came to call his presidency the hidden hand presidency.
Fred Greenstein calls it the hidden hand presidency. But I think there are obvious defects to the hidden hand presidency. FDR used to say the presidency is preeminently a place of moral leadership. TR called it a bully pulpit. You miss a large point of the presidency if you do everything through a hidden hand.
Nowhere was Eisenhower's indirect style more apparent than in his efforts to undermine Senator Joseph McCarthy.
Eisenhower gave orders early in his first term that one of his objectives was to destroy McCarthy. At the same time, he realized and said to the cabinet that he didn't think that Truman's method of dealing with McCarthy had been successful. Truman had denounced McCarthy from the Oval Office, and that just fueled the controversy, created headlines for McCarthy, and McCarthy loved that.
Nothing will be so effective in combating this kind of troublemaking as to ignore him, Eisenhower wrote. This he cannot stand. The president's interest quickened in late 1953 when McCarthy began to probe for communists in the U.S. Army. McCarthy charged Army dentist Irving Perez with communist affiliations. He then lambasted Perez's commanding officer for not preventing the dentist's automatic promotion.
Any man who has been given the honor of being promoted to general and who protects communists is not fit to wear that uniform, General.
McCarthy, who never in his life caught a communist spy but was always after them, turned on the Perez case to show that the army itself was, if you will, was soft on communism, and berated army officers for his promotion, got into a terrible brawl with the Defense Department over it, and drove Eisenhower up the wall.
Eisenhower had asked his staff to find a way to undermine McCarthy, and they did. After one of McCarthy's aides, David Schein, was drafted, McCarthy tried to use his influence to get Schein cushy assignments. The Army kept records of these attempts for preferential treatment, and Eisenhower's staff gave them to all members of McCarthy's committee. That turned the tables. McCarthy's quest for who in the Army promoted the pink dentist became also a hearing on the Army's charge of influence peddling.
that time, Senator McCarthy informed me that he was very much interested in obtaining a direct reserve commission for his consultant, Mr. G. David Shine.
McCarthy fought back, probing for details of the meeting where Eisenhower aides decided to investigate him.
The president then issued an executive order which instructed everyone in the executive branch not to answer McCarthy's subpoenas. He cut off the fodder, so to speak, for the day-to-day examination by McCarthy of employees in the executive branch, and it was very effective in bringing the McCarthy era to an end.
Must admit that I'm somewhat at a loss as to know what to do at this moment. I don't believe that this is the result of President Eisenhower's own personal thinking.
But it was, and it worked. Eisenhower prevented McCarthy from rummaging at will through White House files. With the exposure of the hearings, televised for 8 weeks to 20 million Americans, McCarthy's credibility plummeted.
Now, I just give this man's record, and I want to say, Mr. Welch, that it has been labeled.
Let us not assassinate this man further, Senator. You've done enough. Have you no sense of decency, sir, at long last? Have you left no sense of decency? You, Mr. Chairman, may, if you will, call the next witness.
After the hearings ended, McCarthy was censured by his Senate colleagues.
It was not a noble chapter in American history, nor did Eisenhower behave with much courage in confronting it. He let nature take its course, and eventually McCarthy self-destructed. I don't see how Eisenhower can claim credit for it.
What I hoped Eisenhower would do, and what I still wish he had, was deliver one great speech about the evils of McCarthy and McCarthyism. We're going to have more McCarthys as time goes by. It's inevitable. And Eisenhower was then a great voice. He would have been listened to. His speech would have had enormous impact.
If Eisenhower had confronted him head-on, it's not obvious who would have won. In fact, as I studied this episode and looked very closely about it, I began examining some of the public opinion polls, and what I concluded was that by handling McCarthy more indirectly and letting things move to the point where the Senate confronted him and where McCarthy gradually undermined himself in public, I think Eisenhower did almost a perfect job of contributing to the downfall of Joe McCarthy.
The communists that concerned Eisenhower the most were not in the U.S. Army. They were in Moscow and in Peking.